He said he was going to give them to you. And those of you who weren't here, I was not here last week. And Ken and Bill Lester, priest, who's been a priest for, well, working on 58 years, supplied for me. And he gave a test, and these are the results. So if you missed last week, you
we heard it.
Well, you, I don't know if that makes you feel good or not. I don't know, but at any rate, what that tells me is I need to do a better job. But it was good, and Zach, I got to hand it to you. You did a great job. Zach to every Sunday from now on. I'm sure he's got the focus on. But anyway, it's good to be back with you. And I got some things I do want to share with you today. They kind of dovetail, follow up on Ken and Bill's message to you last week a little bit. Do you all know that you will live forever? I hope everybody knows that. If you don't know, if there's anybody here that doesn't know that, that is what the Bible teaches. You will live forever. You will. But another way to think about things is it also you're terminal. Every one of us, we're terminal. None of us, as I said before, you've heard other preachers say it, none of us are getting out of here alive. None of us. Your body is temporal, but your spirit is eternal. And yes, you'll get a resurrected body someday, but that doesn't necessarily always have to mean something good. And so the choice is yours and mine for how to deal with that. You know, the whole thing about the resurrection of Jesus is that that gives us incredible hope for all of life, not just the here and now, but especially for the hereafter. When these bodies do give up and we pass through death's door, it gives us hope for all of that stuff. All of that stuff. Sunday, Easter Sunday, is really not about Easter eggs and bunnies. Chocolate, as much as I like chocolate, I mean, that's good. But it's about Jesus rising from the dead. What's that old saying? The Trix commercial? Silly rabbit, tricks are for kids. Well, silly rabbits, Easter is for Jesus. The resurrection is for Jesus, and his resurrection is for you and me as well. Is for us. But as I said, you're terminal. Every one of us. Some of you know, most of you know, the reason I wasn't here last week is because my brother, who's been fighting cancer, bone marrow cancer, a couple Mondays ago, was given his verdict that he's not, at least the medical community says he's not going to be healed. His bone marrow cancer is back, the leukemia is back, and they said, well, you might go in a few days, you might linger for weeks. And so, you know, I basically dropped everything and went up there to see him. And when I got in there to see him, and it was a great visit. He was pretty much with it most all the time. There were some evidences of him kind of losing it, and they were saying, you know, well, what's happening? Where am I? What's going on? Type of thing. But for the most part, that was very infrequent. You know, I asked him, so how are you feeling? How are you doing with this? And he said, you know, when they told me, I was sad. I was depressed. I thought I was going to beat this. And who knows, he may still. You know, God is in control, not us, not the medical community, not their words, but God is in control. But it would be a major miracle if he gets healed from this. And Lord, we're open to that. We're open. I'm open to that. I bet you Terry is too. But at any rate, but you know that it didn't last. It didn't last. Because, well, I know where I'm going. I know where I'm going. I've been preparing for this, in a sense, for 30 years. I know when his conversion was, roughly speaking. It was back when I was in seminary in the 1980s. And he had an experience that was a devastating experience for him, but it was a good experience because it led him to realize, you know, there's a whole lot more to life than what I can control as a surgeon. That's what he was. He was a surgeon. There's a whole lot more, and something just happened here that I cannot explain at all. He says, you know, this is obviously my paraphrase. He said, this God stuff, it's got to be real. And from then on, he'd been on a trek to learn as much as he could. And he was a good Bible teacher, an excellent Bible teacher. The fact is, he had a radio program for about 5 years, half an hour teaching with a pastor every Friday afternoon for 30 minutes. And that, like I said, that went on for years. But he says, this is what I've been preparing for, so why should I be sad? I'm going home. I'm getting to go home. And so, yeah, resurrection is not about Easter bunnies and eggs and chocolate and all that kind of stuff. But it's about what do we do with the resurrection of Christ? What do we do with his death on the cross? What have we done? What are we going to do from here on out? And that's where I want to jump into this passage from Paul's letter to the Corinthians. What is an appropriate response? I was at the sunrise service this morning at 6:30. Anybody else go to that? I didn't see any of you there. Okay. Down at Lake Silver, I think it is, in Martin Luther King Park, Pastor Steve Negley gave the sermon, the homily, and one of his things was about the appropriate response to the resurrection. How do we show our gratitude? How do we deal with life? And I thought, though, you know, that is positive, and it goes right along with what Paul writes here in 1 Corinthians 15. I'm just going to look at the first two verses. Let me read it again to you. Now, I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. Unless you believed in vain. If you look at Paul's travels in the book of Acts, you'll see that when he went to a new community, he went to the synagogue, or he went to where there was a gathering, and he preached. He preached the word. He expounded the Old Testament to show that Jesus was the expected Messiah. He fulfilled all those prophecies. He went on and on about that, and then basically called people to place their faith in the risen Christ. Very much like we do today. Well, hey, maybe there's something. That's what we're supposed to be doing. Like what they did in the New Testament. That's good. All those travels are recorded in Acts, or at least most of them. And people had the option to receive. I mean, that's what John writes in his gospel early on. I make reference to it often about Jesus when he's opening up and starting to talk about the life of Jesus. He says that he came to his own people. He came to his own, but his own people did not receive him. But to those who received him and believed in his name, on his name, he gave them the power, the authority to become children of God. To become children. They were not that just because they were alive and breathing and taking nourishment. They had to become children of God. And so Paul preached that message to them. They received it. He says, of the gospel, I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand. The idea there is that they believed it, but it didn't stop there. Just as the same way when a baby is born, he doesn't stop. She doesn't stop there. We don't leave the baby at the hospital. We take the baby home. We nurture it. And the day comes where he or she starts to grow on their own, starts to live on their own. We hope that happens. And that's the same thing spiritually speaking. Remember, you're a physical body, but even more importantly, you're a spirit. Sometimes people say, well, I'm just having a spiritual experience here. But that's actually backwards. We are spirits that are having a physical experience. And it may last however many years it lasts until this body, you know, gives up. But in which you stand, it means to remain steadfast in what they had learned, and that action of their life, the way they lived their life, was in agreement with what they say they believe. I know that Canon Bill said last week that on some of these cards, people said, well, I'm, you know, and he asked two questions. Left that out. For those of you who weren't here, when you die, are you going to heaven? Yes, no, well, I'm not so sure. And then the second question was, well, when you die and you meet somebody at the gate to heaven, whether that's St. Peter, an angel, Jesus himself, or whoever, he said, and they ask you the question, well, why should I let you into heaven? What's your answer? Write that down. And he gave everybody a few moments to write it down. And then he read some of the answers. And the answers that he didn't want to throw on the ground. And he threw quite a few on the ground.
Most of them.
That's why I say, I got to do a better job. And some of the answers were because I believe. That needs to be unpacked a little bit more. And he pointed out, and I hope you know this, if you don't know this as well, this may be a revelation. He pointed out that the devil believes. The Bible tells us that the devil believes in Jesus. Not in a saving way, but just intellectually, and is not following him, obviously. So to say I believe would be in agreement with the devil. That don't work. That doesn't cut it. So if you say you believe, you have to expand that just a little bit more and say, I believe, I'm trusting in Jesus Christ for my salvation, or for being saved. I'm trusting. Just as you're sitting in those chairs and you're trusting that chair, we trust Jesus. And that works itself out in the way we live our life. The things that we choose to do and the things that we choose not to do. And that's what Paul is really talking about here, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved, he says. You are being saved. I thought, how many of you heard said, if you pray a prayer, commit your life to Christ, you're saved? Has anybody heard that here? I don't see any hands going up. That's very common out there. Well, you got to do that. You got to make a profession of faith. But that's, again, that's the beginning. That's not the whole story. And so he says, in which you are being saved. That's a process. That's an ongoing process. You know, sometimes we'll use the term justification. Sometimes we'll use the term sanctification. Well, justification is when you proclaim it. If you were here for Good Friday, or you read the Passion narratives about the three thieves on the cross, remember the one fellow said to Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. He didn't get off the cross and go work for Jesus. But Jesus said, today you'll be with me in paradise. We start. And then once we start, then we live it out. If we have that freedom, if we have that ability. And that's where, addressing this congregation in Corinth, they said, you do have the ability to work it out. And by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preach to you. You don't get to choose. I don't get to choose. We don't get to choose what God has said to us. We may go to a particular passage and say, man, that really floats my boat. I like that. And we may find another passage and say, boy, that puts a hole in my boat. My boat sinks at that. But we deal with it all. If you hold fast to the word I preach to you, which was the Old Testament. You know, Jesus is recorded in the Gospel of Matthew, in the Sermon on the Mount, where people have come to him, and Jesus said to them, you know, not all who say to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. You remember that passage? Mm-hmm. Not everyone who says to me, speaks it out, confesses, yes, Jesus, you're my Savior, my Lord, is going to make it into heaven. But those who do the will of my Father. And the response is that he got from that, he says, but yeah, but hey, we did all these wonderful things in your name. And he says something that is one of the most scariest verses in the entire Bible. Amen. He says, I never knew you. Depart from me, you evildoer, or you worker of iniquity. I hope that nobody here this morning ever hears Jesus say to you, depart from me. That's where the way we live our life after we receive the gift of salvation, the gift of eternal life, the gift of fellowship with God because of Jesus' work on the cross, then it's manifest by the way we live our life afterwards. And it can be manifest every day, everywhere. perfectly? No. That's why we'll have the confession in a little while. You know, the Anglican tradition, it's permissible, although I never do it, permissible to omit the confession all through Easter season. I don't do that because I know my heart. And I think I got an idea about the way your heart might be too. That maybe we need the general confession even during Easter season. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father. And he says again, if you hold fast to the word that I preached, so justification, but then sanctification, remaining steadfast in action and things that we claim to believe. You know, I read something that was just so disturbing a couple days ago. And it was on Facebook. I don't know if you like Facebook, you hate Facebook. It doesn't matter. There's some information there. But a fellow I know pointed to a college, a so-called Christian college. I won't tell you where it is, and I won't tell you what denomination it's associated with, but it is teaching things that I will not even repeat here in front of you. It is so blasphemous. So blasphemous, things that they said about Jesus and what his death on the cross meant and everything. It is just, I mean, it just, how in the world can this be called Christian? And the individual that is making those claims has done it for a while, a long time, and even before this college hired him, they knew he was of this mindset. And yet, it was just blasphemy. You know, Jesus says at the end of John's Gospel, he says, as the Father sent me, so I send you. And one of the things that Jesus said right at the very end of his ministry, before his crucifixion, he said, I glorify, talking to his Father, this is his high priestly prayer, he's talking to his Heavenly Father, and he says, I glorified you on earth, having accomplished the work that you gave me to do. Having accomplished the work that you gave me to do. And then Jesus says, as the Father sent me, so I'm sending you. Does that mean that you and I have some work to do? Absolutely. How do we know what that work is?
Read the Bible.
It's right here. If you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. That's another scary verse. My mind goes back to Matthew 7. You know, some of you who say to me, Lord, Lord, will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Believing in our mind is not enough. Some of you have taken the Truth Project. It's a course that we offer here. How many of you have done that course? I'm curious that are present here. I see a number of hands. I encourage every one of you to take it. Some people don't like it because it really pushes the envelope of, do you really believe? They have a question in that is just, it's a bit of a tongue twister. Dr. Del Tackett asks the question. He says it haunts him. He says, I'm going to share it with you so it will haunt you too. He says, do you really believe that what you believe is really real? Do you really believe that what you believe is really real? And how do you know? How do you answer that question? Do you really believe? Well, I may say it, but if it doesn't show up in my actions, then I'm lying. I don't believe it. Does that make sense? I hope that makes sense. You know, last night, went with John and Mary Lee and Margaret to a Seder supper over at a Messianic Jewish congregation over in Lakeland. And at the end of the evening, the rabbi, you know, stood up and asked people, if you haven't committed your life to Jesus, maybe you ought to do that tonight. Maybe you ought to not let it go. My brother knows pretty much he's at the end of his life, but any one of us could walk out of here today and be hit with who knows what. Something medical, maybe something physical, something. And some people don't know when they're going to die. They don't know how it's going to come. Fact is, maybe that would be true for most of us. So you know, when Paul preached, he talked about repenting. What am I doing that I know God doesn't really want me to do? What am am I not doing that I know God really does want me to do? Repent. Change our minds, saying, yes, it's important for me to address that. But then adjust your life. Change your life. Ask God for the power of the Spirit to come upon you and change your life, that indeed Jesus might be able to be seen in us, in the church, more than he is being able to be seen now. Accept Christ as your Savior. Follow him as your Lord. And then these words that Paul wrote to the Corinthians will be true for us. I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. You know, I hope this doesn't come across as me painting God as vindictive, but I hope it comes across as loving. Loving and caring, providing everything for every one of us, but wanting us to separate, be separated from sin. And after our justification, it takes us our willingness to move along with that program, that sanctification. The whole idea is for us to go out and live and embrace a weary and a despairing world. Would you say that maybe we run into some people out in the world that despair of life, that despair of the way the world is going, that are just worried about everything, that are just weary? For us to go out and maybe minister God's love to them in some way, for his glory. For his glory. Not because it makes us feel good, as well, as wonderful as that may be, but for his glory. So on this Resurrection Sunday, Lord, we give thanks to God for the resurrection of Christ, because that is proof positive that everything that Jesus said is true. True for you, true for me, and true for everybody. Everybody that's out there. And there are people dying to hear the gospel. Who can we share it with? How can we let the light of Christ shine through us even more and rejoice in our salvation and in the fact that God loves us and died for us, rose for us, gives us the Spirit to be in fellowship with him and to go out and live for him. Father God, we thank you. We thank you. We can never thank you enough. Help us, deliver us from the times that well, we all maybe fall into thinking, well, do I have to do that? Well, yeah, maybe we should. But not to earn our salvation, but to give glory to you, to honor you, to worship you, to thank you, and to help another individual who maybe needs to know Jesus, or maybe just needs to be encouraged by the Spirit of God that is present with us, to be helped along, to be able to see Jesus in us. Father, thank you. You've done it all. There's nothing we can add to our needs for salvation. And everything we do is just a way of saying thank you. So, Father, may you glorify Christ in us and through us by the power of your Spirit and the unity of the work that you have given us, not to do alone, but to do with you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Holy Spirit. It's all in your name, Lord Christ, that we pray. Amen.